Hello everybody, and welcome back to this channel. My name is Sarah. So in celebration of having already 1,000 subscribers on this channel, I thought it'd be nice for you to get to know me a little bit better. And so in my last video and on Instagram, I asked you to send me questions, and I've gathered them here with me today, and hopefully I'll get to all of them. So grab some tea, some coffee, some sewing, hand sewing, knitting, whatever you'd like to keep your hands busy. This is going to be a chatty video. In the meantime, I figured I'd keep my hands busy as well. And I have this skirt with me. This is one of the skirts, or one of the pieces that I showed you in my last video, this skirt that I absolutely love wearing in the fall. I wore it with taller boots. Usually I wear it with ankle boots. And I don't know if you can see, but the facing, I hand stitched it down when I made it with this sort of stitch. I can't remember what it's called, but it kind of sticks out a little bit beyond the facing, and it kept getting caught up in the zipper of my boot. And I had a bit of a wardrobe crisis while I was out. It came unattached, and I ended up having to just clip it back on with just a hairpin. Luckily, I have very thick hair and require lots and lots of hair accessories to keep it in place, and therefore I had a spare bobby pin ready to use. So I will be ripping out those stitches and re-stitching this hem facing down, just because I want to kind of hide the stitches a little bit further underneath the facing. Because I do want to wear it with higher boots. It keeps me warmer and it prolongs the amount of time I can wear this skirt. So that's always good. So the first question I got was, how often or how much time do I spend sewing in a day or a week? And that actually really depends, because my sewing motivation varies a lot depending on the time of year, my energy levels, what's going on, how tired I am after work one day. I find that sewing is, it's not a very physical activity, but it can be more physical than sitting and watching TV or knitting, for example. And so I find that sometimes when I'm physically exhausted, I just don't want to sew. Or when I'm mentally exhausted, I also don't really want to sew. And there came a period last year where I ended up not sewing for, I think, a good 2 or 3 months. And I think it was because I was working 2 jobs at a time. I have a full-time job, and then sometimes I teach on the side, and it was taking up a lot of my free time in that I was thinking about it all the time, and when I got home in the evenings, I just wanted to relax and turn off my brain. And sewing requires a good amount of brain power, actually. I was a little bit worried about that when I started this channel, just because I thought, well, what if I go through another period like that where I'm not sewing for 2 to 3 months? And then I realized that even if I'm not making new garments, I have my whole closet of handmade garments to show you, and the ways that I style my garments, and I wear them all the time. And I'm constantly thinking of new projects and thinking about sewing. And so I think I have plenty of things to share and to connect with you on this channel, even if I do experience another period like that. But to get back to the question and not change the subject, I would say if I'm not too tired after work, I like to sew in larger chunks of time, which I realize is a luxury. And some people don't have that. I typically sew after dinner, when I've kind of relaxed after getting home from work and taken a shower and kind of gotten in my pajamas. And I usually sew 2 to 3 hours in the evening, but that's typically maybe once or twice a week. I'm typically too tired even, or I have things going on. I'm seeing friends, or I'm going to a fitness class or something like that. So most of my sewing happens on the weekends, and it depends on what I'm doing that weekend. Some weeks I don't sew at all. Like this week, I was sick over the weekend and I didn't have time during the week, so I ended up maybe sewing 4 or 5 hours total. And sometimes I'm really motivated, I have lots of energy, I have lots of time, and I sew a lot more. So that's a hard question to answer. Another question I got was, where do you recommend starting if you want to make your own clothing? That is a complicated question, and I've already thought of making an entire video of the pattern companies that I would recommend for beginner garment sewists, just because it is very difficult to start, because it requires a lot of materials, but then also it takes a while to figure out one's body type and the silhouettes that one likes to wear, your style, the colors that suit you, and then how to match fabric with different patterns. And so I would suggest starting already with easy fabrics to work with that take steam well, that you can press and practice pressing and working with. And that would be more cottons and linens, but sometimes I find cottons to be inflexible and sometimes difficult to work with. I would recommend blend fabrics, such as cotton and viscose blends or linen and viscose blends, just because they're a bit softer and a little bit bouncier, and you can kind of shape them with your hands underneath the machine and with steam a little bit better. And I find that they're a little bit more flexible and easier to work with if you make mistakes. All you have to do is steam it and the holes, you know, the holes that the needles have made in the fabric disappear. And yeah, I much prefer fabrics that are a little more flexible. This, for example, is a viscose twill, and you can see it's very soft and a little bit bouncy, and I especially like the way it feels in my hands because I was working with it quite a lot, and that's also why I enjoy hand sewing with it. And you can kind of see there's a bit more ease, and so you can kind of ease it through the machine a little bit better or ease it together, the different shapes, and I like this kind of fabric. But this is a little bit drapier than I would suggest for a beginner project. But yeah, definitely a cotton or linen viscose blend. And then to talk about a little bit of my beginnings in my sewing journey, I started making, I think I made a bag first. If I find a picture, I'll insert it here. But I was really impatient to start making clothes. And my first pattern, I think it was called the Sorbetto Top by Colette Patterns. And the Sorbetto Top was a free pattern. And I tried it because I was just really impatient to make clothes, and I didn't want to make household items or bags and things after a little while. And I went through a bunch of different flops. It took me a long time to figure out which fabrics to pick and which ones actually looked good. And remember to be patient with yourself and know that you learn best through your mistakes and figuring out how to fix them, and that sewing, typically you can fix it. And then I got another question, and it was, what are your essential sewing tools, or what are essential sewing tools in general? And ooh, that is an entire video on its own. There are so many. The thing about sewing is it's a little bit of an investment to get started. And so I'd like to give you good advice, but already these are very important. These embroidery scissors, I use them for unpicking as well as just cutting threads. But I will do an entire video on what I personally recommend for essential sewing tools. And I promise you, I will do that very soon. This is actually a question from a friend. And I told her, pinky promise, I will get that up for the end of January. So I promise to you too. Another question I got was, where do you buy fabric? I actually buy a lot of fabric online, even though I do live near Paris and I could go in and have access to a lot of really great fabric shops. But I live in the southern suburbs of Paris, and so getting to the fabric shops, which are more by the Cyclico, which is in the north of Paris, takes me a good hour. And even though I do really appreciate being able to go and look at the fabrics and look at them and their colors and get a feel for their hand and touch, I find that I make a lot more impulsive purchases when I go into fabric shops because I don't have as much time to think about what kind of projects that I want to do. And in Paris, a lot of fabrics are sold in coupon, which is like pre-cut lengths of fabric, and it's usually a meter and a half or 3 meters at a time. Typically, I end up getting 3 meters just in case. And so, yeah, I appreciate being able to, when I buy fabrics online, think about it over days and figure out what I want to do with that fabric. A lot of the fabric that I buy is actually dead stock fabric, which means that it is from different fashion lines or store brands, and it's the leftover fabric from their collections. So it's not made specifically for amateur dress sewing. It's made for I don't know, H&M, Cezanne, different brands and also different qualities. Usually you don't know where it's coming from, but I much prefer working with those fabrics because I find they're usually a bit more unique and interesting in their compositions. For example, this is a deadstock fabric, this viscose twill, and I think it's a poly twill, so a little bit of polyester and a little bit of viscose, and it's just, you can see it's kind of pilling a little bit because I've worn it so often. I don't know if you can see that, but I love it. I absolutely love it. I find a lot of really interesting colors and prints. But then if I'm looking for something a little bit more, not basic, but classic and simple, like a good white linen viscose blend or a good double cotton, then sometimes I do buy from places that print specifically for dressmaking. So my favorite shops off the top of my head are Sacré Coupon, which is also based in Paris by the Sacré-Cœur. It's my favorite shop. Every time I go in, I find something that I love, It's dangerous, but I also love following them online, and typically they don't sell out as fast as other shops, and so I can think about it and make good educated decisions about where I'm going to put my money in my hobby without impulse buying. I also purchase fabric from a company called Sew Tissu. They also have a location more in the center of Paris near Châtelet. I haven't actually been to their physical store yet, but I love following them online and they're very friendly people. They have an Instagram account that I highly recommend following. If you speak French, it's not translated into English, but they have beautiful fabric. And I used to buy a lot of fabric from the UK, but now with Brexit, I don't really do that anymore. So I've been discovering more dead stock French fabric shops, and oh, I love them. If I have the budget to splurge a little bit and I want something very specific that I can't find in dead stock fabric, I do sometimes look at Pretty Mercerie or Pretty Mercerie. It's hard, these names that are half in English and half in French. I never know which language to pronounce them in. They have really beautiful fabric, but it is expensive. And then when I go visit family and friends in the United States, I usually allow myself a purchase, and it's sometimes a little bit more of a luxury purchase. Like, I purchase a few nice fabrics, a few as in like a bundle, from Blackbird Fabrics and Closet Core Fabrics, both based in Canada. And oh, their fabrics are just so beautiful. And I would buy from them so much more often if it didn't make me feel so horrible about shipping from across the world and then paying taxes and what is it called? Customs. I absolutely adore their fabrics, and it's just, oh, the nicest quality. I highly recommend them. If you are based in Canada or in the US, you probably know who they are already, but yeah, they're great. I got a series of questions from a subscriber named Justine, and that was very helpful. Thank you very much. And her first question was, how and why did you start your sewing journey? And ooh, I need to think back to that. I think I always felt kind of frustrated about how clothes fit me and what was available to me. Not that I have a very difficult body to fit, but I do have my top half is two sizes smaller than my bottom half. my hips are a size 36 and my bust is a size 31 and a half, 32. And so whenever I was trying on dresses or pieces that weren't two pieces, it was very hard to fit and it didn't fit very well. And then also, when I was much younger, I wanted to make clothes because I was very small up until I was about 18. My body didn't really grow into adulthood until much later, and so I was always very frustrated with how limited my choices were when it came to wearing more adult clothing, and I didn't want to look like a child at age 18, so that was something in my mind. And then I like classic clothing. I like clothing that isn't always following the trends or in trendy colors. I like to be able to choose the silhouettes and shapes and colors that I want. And then I also wanted to make things out of really nice fabrics like wool or viscose and those sorts of garments are much more expensive if they're well made. I think I am finished taking out the hem. And now I can start sewing. So I'll show you what I'm using. I have pre-waxed six strands just to be absolutely sure I have enough of this thread that I think matches relatively well. I don't think I have the original thread that I used. And then I've got my embroidery scissors, and here's the wax that I used. I just bought this a long time ago. This is an old piece of wax that I used to wax. And if you don't know, usually you wax when you're hand sewing your threads so that they're a little bit stronger and they hold a lot longer. And I have this needle, this hand sewing needle, I don't know if you can see it, that is from the needles I bought when I was in Japan back in 2019 when I went to Kyoto. There was a little sewing accessories shop that I found. It was just absolutely idyllic and lovely. And the shop owner there was really welcoming, and he had a lot of really nice sewing accessories, and I bought a few hand sewing needles from him. This is more of the lighter fabrics. I think it's meant for a lighter fabric than this cotton or polyviscose twill, but I think they're so nice to work with. They're so smooth. They just like cut through fabrics like butter, and I absolutely love them. And I'm down to my last third, I think. I think I have three remaining, so I'm not sure where to find needles like that elsewhere. But yeah, here we go. The next question is, which step do you least like in the sewing process? And it's a tie between interfacing and gathering. I think it's interfacing because I have come to terms with the fact that when I'm gathering, so when you're gathering, the hardest part is making sure that the gathers are even, that you have an even amount of fabric gathered at a time and there's not more bulk on one side than another when you're doing, for example, a seam. And you can see behind me, I'm still working on the Dirndo Orchide or Orchide dress. And there are a lot of gathers in this dress, I realized after deciding I was going to make it. And I've come to terms with the fact that I'm a little bit of a perfectionist when it comes to that sort of detail, and so I like to make sure that the gathers are even, and I've stopped putting pressure on myself to do it quickly or efficiently. I have accepted that that's something that I take very seriously and that I get a little bit obsessional about. I've made peace with that and the fact that it takes a longer time. I think interfacing is definitely my pet peeve, especially when it comes to making coats. The last coat that I made, I counted. It took me 16 hours to cut it out and interface it, because usually with the facing of coats, you interface the entire surface area, and I was making a coat that went down to my knees, and that took ages, and it was mind-numbingly boring. So yeah, hands down, without a doubt, interfacing is my least favorite step. Another question was, what is your all-time favorite pattern? And that's really difficult to say because I love so many different patterns and appreciate how they've opened up my wardrobe and what I usually wear outside of my comfort zone, and being so well made have given me confidence. For example, the Closet Core Ginger Jeans comes to mind. That definitely was a sewing experience, but I would say my most worn pattern is the Sew Over It Heather dress. It's actually what I'm wearing right now. It is so easy to throw on, especially when I want to be cozy, and it's the perfect secret pajamas for work, for home, in more formal, more relaxed situations. I just absolutely love it. It's actually quite difficult to concentrate on hand sewing and answering these questions at the same time, but I will do my best. And then another question was, are you more a find a fabric for a specific pattern type or the other way around? And I do both. I am struck by inspiration when a new pattern comes out or when I see someone's make on Instagram, for example, or on YouTube, or when I see new fabric come out. I would say I'm more of an impulse fabric buyer than I am an impulse pattern buyer, just because the patterns will always be there, whereas the fabric may not be. And usually I buy the fabric when I see it and jump on the opportunity to get it and then find the pattern to go along with it. But I have to say I've become a lot more selective about the kind of fabrics that I buy, just because I know I have a good amount of stash of fabrics that I bought when I would go for a print or a color or just something absolutely beautiful, and before I knew what kind of garment it would work for. And in the end, they're not very practical because they're the kinds of things that are blouse weight, but I don't really want to wear close to my face, or absolutely beautiful colors, but not in my color palette and not good with my skin tone and colors. And so I've become a little bit more selective, and I think I recognize a little bit easier what kind of fabrics are worth the splurge. And sometimes it's really frustrating because the kinds of fabrics that are available to us as garment sewers are influenced by what's in fashion at the moment, because deadstock fabric comes from what's on the market now or a season ago. And so I do find that sometimes I pick out patterns and I'm still looking for the fabric that'll go with it. For example, I have in mind, I'd like to make a polka dot black and white bias cut skirt. And it's something that I saw someone wearing on YouTube. It looks absolutely beautiful, but I want something that's a little bit more this weight, and not a really light viscose, and the right size polka dots, which is very particular. But I am determined, and I know that I will find it one day, and it will seem like a magical encounter, and I'm okay with that taking time. And then to get to some of the more personal questions, a few of you had questions about what's it like living in France, things like that, and one of the questions was, why France? And, ooh, how do I talk about France? like, how do I talk about this big love in my life? Let's start with language. I've always been drawn to the French language. Even when I was little, I really loved listening to it. My friend's family took me to Quebec when I was about 12, and I just absolutely loved listening in on the conversations that I was hearing around in the cafes and the streets. When I was little, I wanted to take French when we moved to middle school, because that's when, at my age, we would pick the language that we wanted. My parents told me that, no, French is absolutely useless, you should do Spanish. So in respect for their wishes, I did Spanish and then Latin in high school. And when I got to university, I needed to do, for my English literature major, I needed to do 2 semesters of language, and I thought, ha, this is my opportunity to do French. So I started French classes, and I loved them. I was really passionate about getting better at it, even though I had no idea how I was going to integrate it into my future. And I added it as a double major to my English literature degree at the University of Connecticut. And to finish a major in French, you have to go and study abroad in Paris for at least a semester, which is, oh, what a hardship. but kind of difficult to swing financially. So I came for a semester. It was kind of like it's not only the fact that I appreciate the lifestyle here, and it corresponded to different aspects of me and my personality. For example, just a little one, like, I love bread. And the bread here is phenomenal and available on all street corners, and it's all really good. There's one detail, but there are more serious details that I really appreciate about this country. And there was this feeling, I remember it being around October of that year, or that semester abroad, when I was deciding to stay for 2 semesters instead and to finish my senior year in Paris. It was this deep sensation of belonging, maybe not belonging, but like, this is where I want to be. And immigration is really hard, and I spent a good 5 years fighting to stay. The United States will always have a special place for me in my heart, because it's my country of birth, it's where I grew up, it's where my good friends and family are, it's where my cultural references come from, my sense of humor, and my native language. And I feel most comfortable still expressing myself in English and expressing my personality in English. But France is the country of my heart, and it's the country where I feel like my values align more with the values here, and I'm very, very lucky. Oh, I'm shaking. I'm very lucky. It took a lot of hard work and luck to be able to stay, and I feel very grateful to have been able to make my life here and to put down roots here. So, a bit of a long answer to that question, but there you go. And then the last question that I received, and I am not going to get anywhere near finishing this hem. I underestimate how much time it takes to hand stitch, but it makes me happy. It's meditative, it's fine. The last question is, do you have any tips for becoming fluent in French? And I'm not sure if this person is in a situation where you can listen to French very often, or if you're immersed in the language, but try and speak it as much as possible and try and listen to it as much as possible. When I came to France, I didn't speak very much French. I had only two years of university classes, and I had the present and past tense down. That was about it. And I had time because I was a student, and I found a conversation exchange with someone who has become a dear friend now and who lives between Australia and New York, because she, at the time, she wanted to practice her English and I wanted to practice my French, and she was also a student. And we'd meet once a week in a cafe and for about an hour or two just talk. What you can do is an hour in one language and an hour in another. But what we did was, which was a little bit unorthodox, was she would speak English to me and I would speak French back. And it worked for us. I was really lucky with her to find her, because we got along really well, and we could find, even though we didn't know each other very well, we had just met, we could find things to talk about for 2 hours at a time, and so that was great. And then later, I lived with French people, or I kept up different conversation exchanges and practiced my French, because you have to speak it to become fluent. You have to speak it. And this is something I do with my students, because my second job, which is just a job on the side, is teaching English. It's very, very important to practice. So that's what I'll say about that. So I definitely have not gotten very far in this hem, but I will keep going later. It has gotten even gloomier. It's raining even harder now. So sorry if the lighting has changed a little bit through the course of this video. It's just gotten gray. That's the end of the questions that I got. Thank you for those of you who sent me questions. That was very kind of you. And if you made it this far in the video, leave a sun, a big shiny sun in the comments below for me. And I'll see who got this far. And then if you have further questions that I didn't get to or that you're curious about, don't hesitate to leave them in the comments below, and maybe I'll answer you in the comments, or maybe I'll keep them for a future video, because I do enjoy connecting with you this way. And I think I love these sorts of videos. I love getting to know the YouTubers that I follow a little bit better this way. And so yeah, it doesn't bother me to do this. I hope you have a very nice day, and I will see you again very soon. Bye.